This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Hawks of Hawk Hollow, A Tradition of Pennsylvania, Volume 1. Author: Robert Montgomery Bird. Introduction. "Hear me, but don't believe me, after you have heard," says Calderon, the Spanish dramatic poet, with a droll spirit of honesty, only equaled by the English Burton, who concludes the tale of the prebend in his Anatomy of Melancholy by exclaiming, "You have heard my tale, but alas, it is but a tale, a mere fiction, 'twas never so, never like to be, and so let it rest." We might imitate the frankness of these ancient worthies in regard to the degree of credit which should be accorded to our tradition, but it would be at an expense of greater space and tediousness than we care to bestow upon the reader. We could not declare in the same wholesale way that the following narrative is a mere fabrication, for such it is not, while to let the reader into the secret and point out the different facts, for facts there are, that are interwoven with the long gossamer web of fiction, would be a work of both time and labor. We have always held the Delaware to be the finest and noblest river in the world, not indeed that it is so, but because that was a cardinal item in our creed of childhood. And to all such points of belief we hold as strongly as we can, philosophy and experience to the contrary notwithstanding. They are holy and useful, though flimsy, ties, little pieces of rose-colored packthread that keep sorted together whole bundles of pleasant reminiscences, and therefore as precious in our esteem as shreds of gold and silver. In consequence of this persuasion, we have learned to attach importance to every little legend of adventure in any way associated with the ganga of our affections, and of such it has been our custom, time out of mind, to construct, at least in imagination, little fairy edifices in which golden blocks of truth were united with the cement of fancy. A novel is, at best, a piece of mosaic work of which the materials have been scraped up here and there, sometimes in an unchronicled corner of the world itself, sometimes from the forgotten tablets of a predecessor, sometimes from the decaying pillars of history, sometimes from the little mine of precious stones that is found in the human brain, at least as often as the pearl in the toad's head, of which John Bunyan discourses so poetically in the apology for his Pilgrim's Progress. Of some of the pebbles that we have picked up along the banks of the Delaware, the following story has been constructed, but at what precise place they were gathered, we do not think it needful to say. The torrent of fashionable summer rustication has already sent off a few little rills of visitation towards different corners of Pennsylvania, and one has begun to flow up the channel of the Delaware. In a few years, eheu fugaces, posthume, this one will increase to a flood, all of men, women, and children, rolling on towards the water gap, and then some curious individual will discover the nook into which we have been prying, and perhaps, if he chooses, come off with prizes still more valuable. At all events he will discover, and that we hold to be something worth recording, that his eyes have seldom looked upon a more enchanting series of landscapes than stretches along this river, in one long and varied line of beauty, from New Hope and the Nockamixon Rocks almost to its sources. The story, such as it is rather a domestic tale, treating of incidents and characters common to the whole world, than one of which these components can be considered peculiarly American. This is, perhaps, unfortunate, the tendency of the public taste seeming to require of American authors that they should confine themselves to what is, in subject, event, and character, indigenous to their own hemisphere, although such a requisition would end in reducing their materials to such a stock as might be carried about in a nutshell. America is a part of the great world, and like other parts, has little that is suited to the purposes of fiction which it can call exclusively its own. And how far that little has been already used up anyone may tell who is conversant with our domestic literature. Some little, however, of that little yet remains, and by, we will perhaps ourselves join in the general scramble after it. To conclude our prolegomena, we recommend to all Philadelphians who thirst for the breath of the mountains, and are willing to breathe it within the limits of their own noble state, to repair to the Delaware water gap, sit them down in the porch of our friend Snyder, or Schneider, we forget, whether he yet sticks to the Vaterlandish orthography or not, discourse with him concerning trout, deer, and rattlesnakes, and make themselves at home with him for a week. They will find themselves in one of the boldest mountain passes in the United States, in the heart of a scene, comprising crags, forests, and a river sprinkled with numerous islands, all striking, harmonious, and romantic. There, indeed, is neither a round top nor a Mount Washington, with ladders on which to climb to heaven. But there are certain mountain ridges hard by, from whose tops he who is hardy enough to mount them can well believe he looks down on heaven, so broad, so fair, so Elysian are the prospects that stretch below. There also our friends will find such lime trees as will cause them to rejoice that they have planted scions of the same noble and fragrant race at their own doors, and such a glorious display of rose bays or rhododendrons, the noblest of American flowering shrubs, as may perhaps teach them the wisdom of transferring a few to their own gardens. But we have not space to mention one half the charms that await them in the gap. If they have eyes to distinguish between the flutter of wings and loose hanging mosses, they may behold, at evening, the national bald eagle, soaring among his native cliffs, and winging to his perch on the far-up old hemlock, where they may see his reverend white head gleaming like a snowflake among the leaves, until the wail of the whippoorwill calls the shadows of night over the whole mountain. Besides all this, and the other charms too tedious to mention, if they commend themselves to the favor of mine host, they will be roused up in the morning by the roar of a waterfall under their very pillows, and then, leaping into a boat, and rowing into the river, they may survey it at their ease, as lovely a sheet of foam rushing over a cliff 140 feet high, as was ever stolen from its bed of beauty to drive, eheu, eheu conditionem hujus temporis, the machinery of a sawmill. Volume 1. Chapter 1. What man that sees the ever-whirling wheel of change, the which all mortal thing doth sway, but that thereby doth find, and plainly feely, how mutability in them doth play her cruel sports to many men's decay? Spenser, Fairy Queen. America is especially the land of change. From the moment of discovery, its history has been a record of convulsions, such as necessarily attend a transition from barbarism to civilization, and to the end of time, it will witness those revolutions in society which arise in a community unshackled by the restraints of prerogative. As no law of primogeniture can ever entail the distinctions meritoriously won, or the wealth painfully amassed by a single individual upon a line of descendants, the mutations in the condition of families will be perpetual. The Dives of today will be the Diogenes of tomorrow, and the man of the tub will often live to see his children change place with those of the palace builder. As it has been, so will it be. Now up, now down, as bucket in a well. And the honored and admired of one generation will be forgotten among the moth-lived luminaries of the next. That American labors under a melancholy infatuation, who hopes, in the persons of his progeny, to preserve the state and consideration he has acquired for himself. He cannot bequeath, along with lands and houses, the wisdom and good fortune which obtained them, nor can he devise preventatives against the natural consequences of folly and waste. His edifice of pride must crumble to dust, when both cornerstone and hypogeum are based upon the contingencies of expectation, and the funeral stone and the elm of his family mausoleum will vanish, in course of time, before the axe and plow of a new proprietor. This is the ordinance of nature, who, if she scatters her good gifts of talents with a somewhat despotic capriciousness, is well content that men should employ them in republican and equal rivalry. In a little valley bordering upon the Delaware, there stood, 50 years since, a fair dwelling within an ample domain, which a few years of vicissitude had seen transferred from its founder to a stranger, although wealth and a family of 7 sons, the boldest and strongest in the land, might have seemed to ensure its possession to them during at least 2 generations. The vale lies upon the right bank of the river, embosomed among those swelling hills that skirt the southeastern foot of the Alleghenies, using that term in the broad, generic sense given it by geographers, the principal ridge of which, the Ca'catchlanamen, or Kittatinny, or as it is commonly called, the Blue Mountain, is so near at hand that upon a clear day, the eye can count the pines bristling over its gray and hazy crags. It stretches, indeed, like some military rampart of the Titans, from the right hand to the left, farther than the eye can reach, broken only by the gaps that, for the most part, give passage to rivers, and but for these it would be entirely impassable. The original proprietor of the estate was an English emigrant of humble degree, and at first of painfully contracted circumstances. But having fallen heir to a considerable property in his own land, and events of a very peculiar nature altering the resolution he had formed to enjoy it within the limits of the chalk cliffs of Alban, he sat himself down in good earnest to improve the windfall at home. The little farm which he had cultivated with his own hands was speedily swelled into an extensive manor, and deserting the hovel of logs which had first contented his wants, he built a dwelling house of stone, so spacious and of a style of structure so irregular and fantastic that it had, at a distance, the air rather of a hamlet than a single villa, and indeed looked not unlike a nest of dovecots stuck together on the hillside. Without possessing one single feature of architectural elegance, it had yet a romantic appearance, derived in part from the scenery around, from the beauty of the groves and clumps of trees that environed it, and the vines and trailing flowers that were made in summer at least to conceal many of its deformities. It was exceedingly sequestered also, for except the log hovel, into which Mr. Gilbert, for that was his name, had inducted a poor widow, befriended out of gratitude for kindness shown him, when their respective conditions were not so unequal, there was not another habitation to be seen from his house, though it commanded an extensive prospect even beyond the river. The highway to the neighboring water gap, indeed, ran through the estate. The broad river below often echoed to the cries of boatmen and raftsmen, floating merrily onward to their market, and the village dignified with the title of county town was not above 7 or 8 miles distant, so that the valley was not always invested with a Sabbath day silence. And besides, his protege, the widow, had, with Mr. Gilbert's consent, converted her hovel into a house of entertainment, which sometimes seduced a wayfarer to sojourn for a period in the valley. Mr. Gilbert himself did all he could to add life and bustle to his possessions, by doing honor to such well-behaved villagers, or even strangers, as he could induce to ruralize with him. For having built and planted, and torn down and transplanted, until he knew not well what to do with himself, he hit upon that expedient for driving away ennui which passes for hospitality, namely, converting into guests all proper and indeed improper persons from whom he could derive amusement, and who could assist him to kill time. To this shift he was driven in great part by the undomestic character of his children, who, so soon as they arrived at an age for handling the rifle, individually and infallibly ran off into the woods, until, as the passion for hunting grew with their growth, they might be said almost to live in them. It was this wild propensity, acting upon a disposition unusually self-willed and inflexible, in the case of his eldest boy, Oran, that defeated his scheme of spending the remainder of his days in England. He actually crossed the sea with his whole family, and remained in the neighborhood of Bristol, his native town, for the space of a year. But in that time, Oran, a boy only 12 years old, heartily sick, as he said, of a land where there were no woods and no place where he could get by himself, finding remonstrance and entreaty failed to move his father's heart to his purpose, took the desperate resolution of returning to America alone, which he did, having concealed himself in the hold of a vessel until she was out of the channel. His sufferings were great, but he endured them with incredible fortitude, and finally, after many remarkable adventures, he found himself again in his happy valley, in the charge or protection, if it could be so called, of the good widow Bell, for that was the name of the poor woman befriended by his father. In a few months his father followed him, perhaps instigated by affection, for Oran, being the worst, was therefore the most favored of his children, by the murmurs of the others, or by the discovery he undoubtedly made, that his wealth would secure him, if not equal comfort, at least superior consideration in the new world. Consideration indeed he obtained, and increase of wealth, but the wild manners and habits of his children greatly afflicted him, and having married a second wife, he was induced in the hope of making a gentleman, as he called it, of the boy she bore him, none of the others having that ambition. To commit him to the protection of a sister, the widow of a Jamaica planter, who had divided with him the bequest that had made his fortune, and being childless herself, desired to adopt him as her heir. Thus much of the early history of Mr. Gilbert was recollected with certainty, so late as the year 1782, by the villagers of Hillborough, the county town already mentioned, who had so often shared his hospitality. But long before that time he had vanished, with all his family, from the quiet, beautiful, and well-beloved valley. They were wont to speak with satisfaction of the good dinners they had eaten, the rare wines they had drunk, the merry frolics they had shared in the Hawks Hollow. For so they perversely insisted upon calling what Mr. Gilbert, in right of possession, chose to designate as Avondale, in memory, or in honor of his own buxom river of Somerset. They related to youthful listeners the prophetic sagacity with which they had predicted violent ends to the young Hawks of Hawk Hollow, so they called the young Gilberts, for their disobedience to father and mother, and their unusual passion for a life of adventure. And finally they shook their heads with suspicion and regret when they spoke of Jessie, Gilbert's only daughter, of her early and mysterious death, and still more to them, unaccountable burial. All that could be gathered in relation to this unhappy maiden was dark and unsatisfactory. Her death had seemingly, in some way, produced the destruction of the family and the alienation of the estate. It was an event of more than 20 years back, and from that period until the time of his own sudden flight, Mr. Gilbert's doors were no longer open, and his sons were no more seen associated with the young men of the county. The maiden had died suddenly, and been interred in a private place on the estate. In connection with this event, some, more garrulous than others, were wont to speak of Colonel Falconer, the present proprietor of Hawk Hollow, as having had some agency in the catastrophe, but what it was they either knew not or they feared to speak. Evil suspicions, however, gathered about this gentleman's name, and as he was seldom, if ever, seen in Hawk Hollow in person, but had committed the stewardship of the property to the hands of a distant relative who resided on it, the young felt themselves at liberty to fill up from imagination the sketch left imperfect by the old. And accordingly the colonel, in time, came to be considered by those who had never seen him as one of the darkest-hearted and most dangerous of his species. He was very rich. The station he occupied in the eyes of his country was lofty, and might have been esteemed noble, for he had shed his blood in the great and fearful battle of rights that was now approaching to a close, and after being disabled by severe and honorable wounds, he had changed the sphere of his exertions, and was now as ardent and devoted a patriot in the Senate as he had been before in the field. Yet in this distant quarter these recommendations to favor were forgotten. It was said if he had done good deeds, there were evil ones enough to bury them as in a mountain, and if he had fought well for his country, he had struggled still more devotedly to aggrandize himself. In a word, he was called a hard, avaricious, rapacious man, whose chief business was to enrich himself at the cost of the less patriotic, and who had got the mastery of more sequestrated estates than an honest man could have come by. It was a sin of an unpardonable nature that he had succeeded in getting possession of Hawk Hollow, when there were so many others in the county who had set their hearts upon it. His representative on the estate was a certain Captain John Loring, who, with all the patriotism of his connection, and perhaps a great deal more, had never been able to turn it to any account. On the contrary, beginning the world with an ample patrimony, at the time when Mr. Falconer commenced as an adventurer, he had descended in fortune with a rapidity only to be compared with that of his friend's exaltation. The love of glory had early driven him from his peaceful farm on the Brandywine, and after distinguishing himself as a volunteer in the Indo-Gallic wars of western Pennsylvania, it was his hard fate to bring his career of effective service to a close on what he was always pleased to call the fatal field of Braddock. From that bloody encounter he came off with more honor than profit, and with a body so mangled and a constitution so shattered that a quarter of a century had scarce served to repair the dilapidation of his animal man. but the captain had lost neither his spirit nor his love of glory. At the first trump of the revolution, he donned the panoply of valor. He snatched up the pistols he had taken from a dead Canadian at the fatal field of Braddock, strapped upon his thigh the sword he had received for his services in storming certain Indian forts on the Allegheny River, clapped into his pocket the commission which the colonial government had granted him in reward of that gallant exploit, and reported himself among a crowd of younger patriots as ready to do and die for his country. The commissioners looked at his gray hairs and shattered leg, the latter of which had once been as full of musket bullets as was ever a cartouche box, commended his virtue and enthusiasm, and divided the honors of command among those who were better fitted to do the state service. The captain retired to his patrimonial estate, and there contented himself as well as he could, until the current of conflict, diverted from one bloody channel into another, came surging at last into the pastoral haunts of the Brandywine. At that time, his home was blessed with two children, a gallant boy of 18, and a merry little maiden of 12. But one morning he heard a trumpet pealing over the hills, and a cannon roaring hard by behind the woods. He looked at the face of his son, and the eye of the boy reflected back the fire of his father's spirit. Their horses were saddled in the stalls, and the spurs were already on young Tom Loring's heels. It was enough. The captain carried his son to the grave, but to his own dying day he rejoiced over the young man's fall. On this subject, the captain was commonly considered by his neighbors to be crack-brained. After this came other misfortunes, and the captain was a ruined man, landless, homeless, and childless, save that his little Catherine was still left to share his poverty, and like a lamp in a cavern, to exaggerate rather than enlighten the gloom of his desolation. At this critical juncture, he found a firm and prudent friend in Colonel Falconer, by whom he was installed into the privileges, if not the actual possession of Hawk Hollow, in the supervision and improvement of which he seemed now likely to pass the remainder of his days. How far the kindly feelings of relationship, or how far the influence of his daughter's growing beauty, had contributed to secure him the benevolence of this friend in need, was a question frequently agitated by the curious villagers. It was settled among them that there was a wedding in the wind, but whether the young lady was to share the lot of her distinguished patron, or to be given to his gay and somewhat wild-brained son, was a point on which busybodies were long coming at a conclusion. The captain, though frank enough in his way, was not exactly the individual whom one would think of troubling with impertinent questions. And Miss Loring, however hospitable and courteous, had not yet selected a confidant from among the blooming nymphs of Hillborough. She was, however, the theme of as much admiration as curiosity, and being very beautiful and of manners always gentle and at times irresistibly engaging, the village poet immortalized her in rhyme, and the village bells forgave the eulogium. It remains but to say a word more of the Gilberts, as a necessary introduction to a record designed to rescue the story of their fate from the uncertain and unfaithful lips of tradition. After mingling in all the border wars, both Indian and civil, that, from the time of Braddock's defeat to the dispersion of the Connecticut settlers, distracted the unhappy Susquehanna settlements, they deserted the cause of their countrymen at the beginning of the Revolution, and appeared in the guise of destroying demons at Wyoming on that occasion of massacre, which has given to the spot a celebrity so mournful. In other words, they were traitors and refugees, and however dreadful the reputation they obtained as bold and successful depredators, their fate was such as might have been, and perhaps was, anticipated by themselves. One after another they were cut off, some by the rifle and tomahawk, one even by the halter, and all who did perish by deaths of violence. It was indeed, at the time we speak of, confidently believed that Oran, the eldest of all and the last survivor, had fallen within the space of a year, at a conflict on the banks of the Mohawk, along with other refugees of the neighboring commonwealth with whom he had associated himself. Great were the rejoicings in consequence with all who dwelt among the scenes of his earlier exploits, though some professed to have their doubts on the subject and swore that Oran Gilbert was not to be trusted, dead or alive, until his scalp was seen nailed on the county courthouse door. Chapter 2. Come here, my good hostess, pray how do you do? Where is Cicely so cleanly, and Prudence and Sue? And where is the widow that dwelt here, Prior? The year 1782 was distinguished on the western continent as the close of the Great Contest, which obtained for America the name and privileges of a free nation. The harbingers of peace came flitting into the land with the swallows of spring, and before the autumn had withered into winter, so little doubt prevailed of a speedy reconciliation taking place between Great Britain and the United States, founded upon a full recognition by the former of all the claims of the latter, that the Continental Congress passed a resolve for the reduction of its army to take effect on the first day of the coming year. War was no longer waged upon any scale of magnitude. Such hostilities as continued were conducted almost solely by the desperate and lawless of both parties, and consisted of predatory incursions, occasionally attempted in the wilder parts of the country by some skulking band of refugees, and of expeditions of vengeance, planned and executed in a moment of wrath by the excited sufferers. At this period, the only portion of the states north of the Potomac in the hands of the British was the city of New York with its dependencies. And around these narrow possessions, the lines of the Continental Army were drawn, extending from the highlands of New York to the plains of Monmouth in New Jersey. Military posts therefore existed at no great distance from the Hawks Valley, and although the wild and mountainous country on either bank of the Delaware offered the strongest retreats to men of desperate character, it had been very long since the inhabitants had apprehended any danger from the presence of enemies. In the earlier part of the year, at least, they had no cause for alarm, and accordingly they mingled, without alloy, their raptures at the prospect of returning peace with their rejoicings over the death of Oran Gilbert, the most dreaded and detested of the Hawks of Hawk Hollow. One atrocity had indeed been committed in a neighboring state, which, besides exciting the fiercest indignation, had taught the occupants of the valley how little their security was owing to any relenting of spirit or want of military daring on the part of the refugees, whom the general success of the Republican arms had driven in great numbers into the city of New York. A certain Captain Joshua, or Jonathan Huddy, of the New Jersey State Troops, having been captured after a gallant resistance at one of the posts in Monmouth County of that state by a party of loyalists from New York, was for a while immured in prison, then carried back to his native state, and finally hanged by his captors without trial, sentence, or any authority whatever, except what was derived from the verbal orders of a body of men calling themselves the Board of Directors of the Associated Loyalists. The result of this wanton and brutal murder, and of the failure of the British authorities to bring the chief perpetrator to justice, was an instant order on the part of the American Commander-in-Chief to retaliate upon a British prisoner of equal rank. And before the month of May was over, young Asgill of the British Guards, whose story is familiar to all readers of American history, was conducted to the lines at Morristown to await, in painful uncertainty, the fate that now depended or seemed to depend upon the movements of his countrymen in relation to the true criminal. Late in the spring of this year, Hawk Hollow received a new addition to its society in the person of a stranger, who one pleasant evening rode up to the hovel, which, as was before mentioned, Dame Alice, or as she was more familiarly called, Elsie Bell, had so many years before converted into a house of entertainment. But the credit of the poor woman, now aged, infirm, and almost friendless, had long since departed, and the tongues of the ignorant and foolish, in an age when the most ridiculous superstitions were not wholly confined to the brains of children, had invested her habitation with a character which repelled alike the curious and the weary. Her age, her poverty, her loneliness, her unsocial character, and perhaps also her attachment to the memory of a family all others had learned to detest, had brought her into bad odor, and some thoughtless or malicious persons, having persuaded themselves that a certain famous mortality among their cattle could have been caused by nothing short of witchcraft, it was soon determined that old Elsie had stronger claims to the character of a broom rider than any other person in the county. It was fortunate for her that the imputation fell upon her in a land which once, in the case of an old woman brought before a jury under the same charge, had rendered the wise and humane verdict, that they found her guilty, not of being a witch, but of being suspected.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.